Temple of Elijah. We're in the portable studio tonight. Quite busy schedule. I'm working part-time, I'm working, doing all sorts of stuff. And I'm also a taxi driver for my two wonderful children. I'm being taken over all sides of town. So we're going to keep on going on this journey that we've been going, learning about the life of a prophet. We've looked at Elijah. Now he's already, what you could say, ascended to heaven, transported to the heavenly dimensions, a place outside of time and space. And what a sight that would have been to see. And then Elisha is his disciple, his replacement, the replacement prophet. He comes with a double portion of anointing, though, so he's twice as powerful. So we're reading from 2 Kings and chapter 3. It says, Joram, son of Ahab, became king of Israel in Samaria in the 18th year of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, and he reigned for 12 years. He did evil in the sight of the Lord, but not as his father and mother had done. He got rid of the sacred stone of Baal that his father had made. Nevertheless, he clung to the sins of Jeroboam, son of Nebat, which he had caused Israel to commit. He did not turn away from them. Now Mesha, king of Moab, raised sheep, and he had to pay the king of Israel a tribute of 100,000 lambs and the wool of 100,000 rams. But after Ahab had died, the king of Moab rebelled against the king of Israel. So at that time, King Joram set out from Samaria and mobilized all of Israel. He also sent this message to Jehoshaphat, king of Judah. The king of Moab has rebelled against me. Will you go with me to fight against Moab? I will go with you, he replied. I am as you are, and my people are as your people, my horses as your horses. So, just a little bit of history. If you read through earlier in Kings, it sort of gives the history, and you know how the first king of Israel was David, and he was the king of Israel, and his throne was in Jerusalem. But after David, there was his son Solomon who built the temple, and I can't remember the exact order, but there's a whole list of kings, and you know, they sort of split. So there was then a king of Samaria, which was Israel. So Judah is only the one tribe, and that's the tribe where the lineage of Jesus came from. And so there's always someone, there was always a king in Jerusalem, but that king wasn't always the king over all of Israel. Sometimes it was just the king of Judah. So why am I telling you this? Just out of, a historical context. Some people, you read, not really sure why there's a king of Israel and a king of Judah and what's the difference. And Moab was outside of that region. If you remember, I think it was the king of Moab that got the prophet Balaam. He's the one that in the end the donkey spoke to him. And so that's on the other side of the Jordan River. So they're meant to be a deal where he would give wool and lambs to the king of Israel, and the king of Israel, Ahab's dead, and he's like, oh, I don't really think I need to pay this, arrangement anymore. So Israel and Judah have combined. When it says, I'm as you are, my people are your people, my horses are your horses. It's remembering they're all under the one covenant, the Abrahamic covenant, the Mosaic covenant, where they are actually family. And, they're all in this as a team. And they say, what route shall we attack? He said, through the desert of Edom, he answered. So the king of Israel set out with the king of Judah and the king of Edom. So it looks like as they went through Edom, the king of Edom's like, I'll join you. After a roundabout march of 7 days, the army had no more water for themselves or for the animals with them. Sounds like they're badly prepared for battle if they ran out of water. That would be the first strategy you need to think. I mean, what route shall we attack? He asks, through the desert of Edom. I mean, how dumb is that? Going to war through a desert. And lo and behold, they run out of water for their horses. So it just shows that they're sort of doing things the wrong way. They got into trouble and then they ask, maybe we should seek the prophet. They probably should have sought the prophet first before they got stuck in the desert with no water. So it says here, what? Exclaimed the king of Israel. Has the Lord called us three kings together only to deliver us into the hands of Moab? But Jehoshaphat asks, is there no prophet of the Lord here through whom we may inquire of the Lord? An officer of the king of Israel answered, Elisha, son of Shaphat, is here. He used to pour water on the hands of Elijah. So that's an interesting, there's a little note there, a little B, which I think it's like a translator's note, that it says, or that is, he was Elijah's personal servant. So not only, yeah, I guess there's two ways of looking at those words. And one of them is literally he used to pour water on the hands of Elijah. That's a sign of the closeness. You know, he wasn't just any servant. He wasn't just the servant who helped him get off and on his horse, or he wasn't the servant that looked after his horse. He was a servant that poured water on the hands. And that's, in those days, it wasn't so much of a hygienic thing to clean the hands, because they didn't have the understanding of germs that we have today. It was more the dirt and grime of travel, to be refreshed by the water. That water would be poured on the hands and splashed on the face. And so it's basically showering. You know, if you're out in the desert traveling and walking, there may not be anywhere to bathe, or, they definitely wouldn't have had a shower, but, a shower in the form of splashing water and cleaning the grime off. It's an intimate time, when he's pouring water on the hands. So it shows the closeness of Elijah and Elisha, and, everyone knew of that relationship. Therefore, they knew something was passed on. If Elijah was the greatest prophet, the stories of Elijah being told across all of Israel and Judah. And now there's a chance to meet his servant, his close servant, and his successor. So we Where was I? Verse 12. Jehoshaphat said, the word of the Lord is with him. So the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat said, and the king of Edom went down to him. Elisha said to the king of Israel, why do you want to involve me? Go to the prophet of your father and the prophet of your mother. So he's like, he doesn't really see the king of Israel, Joram, as a man of after God's heart. And therefore, he's gone, go see the prophet of your mother. Remember, they were the ones that, the prophets of Baal that Elijah challenged. Let's see who's got the real God. And he poured the water over the wood and said, whoever can call fire from heaven, that's who has the real God. So all those false prophets. Now, no, the king of Israel answered, because it was the Lord who called us three kings together to deliver us into the hands of Moab. Elijah said, as surely as the Lord Almighty lives, whom I serve, if I did not have respect for the presence of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, I would not pay any attention to you. But now, bring me a harpist. Wow. So he wasn't interested in giving any prophecy to the king of Israel. So in the prophetic ministry, just because you might have prophetic insight doesn't mean you have to share that. If we've just come through that situation where, remember, the boys called him Baldy and the bear came and ate the boys, they didn't show respect to the prophet. And I think we underestimate in the body of Christ the respect that should be shown to people in the prophetic ministry. And the spirit of the prophet is subject to the prophet. So just because Elijah had insight into what was going to happen, or he could have gained insight, he's like, I don't want to give you any word. You don't deserve it. You're on your own. But then he said, it's because of Jehoshaphat. He had respect for the king of Judah. And so he said, bring me a harpist. And it says, while the harpist was playing, the hand of the Lord came on Elisha. So it's like the anointing came down, the hand of the Lord, the Spirit of God came and rested on Elijah in the midst of the anointed playing of the harp. And that's why we can't underestimate music as a way of connecting into the spiritual realm and to tapping into the anointing of God and the prophetic it's like Elisha knew, like, there's a zone, there's that, you know, that place where the spirit flows, and if he's not there, he's not going to get a clear indication what God's saying. So sometimes, you know, you might be in a situation, if you're walking in the prophetic and people are saying, give us a word, give us a word, you don't have to feel pressured that you've got to hear a word right then and there. You can say, hang on, let's worship God, or let's just sit under the anointed ministry of some anointed guitar player. And it might take an hour, it might take 2 hours. We don't know how long this harp has had to play before the hand of the Lord came on Elijah. So you know, it didn't. He didn't need a drummer. He didn't need a keyboard player. He didn't need any. He didn't even need a singer. Okay. There was no worship band. There was no lights. There was no smoke machine. There was no disco light shining brightly all across the, you know, auditorium. No, it was just a harpist. But that harpist could play the most beautiful sound. Sometimes it's okay to scale back, you know, when we're looking and seeking after the anointing. One guitar might be all we need, you know. And then he said, this is what the Lord says. I will fill this valley with pools of water. We might leave it there. I think this has been a long enough teaching. So the main thing I think we can get out of today is really having a respect for the prophetic ministry, and understanding, you know, that there are times and places that the word will come, and it's like sort of tuning in to the voice of God. Sometimes you'll need that anointing coming from the music, the strings, as those sounds come. It's connecting into the heavenly dimension and allowing that anointing to break through, and the hand of God was resting on Elijah. That's powerful insight. Powerful insight. You know, sometimes we think, you know, we should be praying and seeking God and, you know, doing all these things. Sometimes all we needed to do is just sit back. You know, I'm blessed that one of my good friends is one of the best guitar players in Australia. And, you know, he's anointed. He's like a psalmist. He's like, he was playing out on the streets. He was telling me a few months ago, he's playing out on the streets. And this guy just came across with tears in his eyes saying, what are you playing? Why is it affecting me like this? And he's able to say, that's because the Holy Spirit is in the sounds. The anointing is going out into the streets, and it's touching you, and it's convicting you, it's drawing you to God. So there's a great need for this type of ministry in the body of Christ. Yeah, we'll just leave it there. So anyway, God bless. Please like and subscribe and share. The School of Elijah Ministry. If you like or was blessed by anything you heard tonight, yeah, just pray that this keeps going and we can help the body of Christ to be strong, especially in the area of the prophetic, because that is an area that's just a little bit misunderstood, I reckon. So God bless. Love you all.